It was the voice of summer, that rich Hampshire burr, said to be nurtured on Stilton and fine Burgundy, became inseparable from Test match cricket in this country. Then, last year, at the age of 66, John Arlott came to live here on the tiny island of Alderney.
I've got islanditis, and there's not a better place to have it than this, because wherever you look, you realise you're not. It's got this amazing effect. You walk, anybody in Alderney will tell you this, as some roads you walk down, you really feel that the whole island is in a cup of the sea, and the sea is a wall. I know it's really only the effect of walking down a slope, but it's a bewildering impression.
When you gave up your Test match commentary, people who didn't know you well almost thought of it as a retirement. It's hardly retirement what you have here, is it?
Well, I've withdrawn from what I suppose was generally regarded as, you know, my most important activity. It was certainly the one that was best known. And it wasn't. I needed to retire from that, really. I mean, I could do a day's commentary and report the match as well, but I wasn't very pleased when I came out at 20-7 on the last day with 240 miles to drive home. And then I started to fall asleep during the Sunday matches. Not from boredom, but the fact that at my age you do fall asleep an hour after lunch. And while Bill Frindle was there, of course, he used to wake me. But then we got a new scorer who was a bit on the timid side. And on one occasion, he tugged my sleeve and he said, "Are you all right?" I said, "Yes, of course I'm all right. Why?" He said, "Well, you've scored 15 runs since you last spoke." Which, I must say, forced the idea of retirement strongly into my mind.
It seems odd that you, of all people, should have islanditis, because I'd have thought you were a fairly gregarious person.
I suppose I'm gregarious. I like company, but I like company in small loads. I don't like big parties at all. I like the number of people you can get round a table. That seems to me, you know, not too big a table. It seems that's my idea of a party and company and of entertainment. However much money I had, if I went on a holiday in the wine districts of the world, I couldn't buy what you get going as a wine correspondent, where the makers of the wine talk to you, take you round, and you may... I went to Rioja recently, my wife and myself, and met about, 20 wine producers in the course of 6 days, lunched with them, dined with them, tasted their wine, discussed the way they made their wine. And this is the sort of thing you couldn't buy. And if you're really interested, this is the real satisfaction in wine is... God, no, that's not true. The real satisfaction in wine is drinking it. But there's also looking at it, smelling it, collecting it, talking about it. It's the drink you talk about above all. It's the thing you discuss. And through a meal, when you're drinking wine, it somehow links the meal, links the dishes, links the conversation.
Your son is now involved in the wine business, is he?
Yes, he's in the wine business. He knows a fair bit about it. He's got a bad critical palate, really, for an 18-year-old. Well, he's done some of the hard work, the humping of the cases and the barrels, and worked in the cellars in France. He knows a fair bit about it, and he was a most superb cellar man. He used to look after my big collection. He knew where the stuff was, and didn't need a list at all. He could go unerringly to the shelf to find a specific bottle.
Three, there's a third.
Chapoutier.
Oh, which one do you want?
Oh, this one.
Okay.
And decant it?
Yeah.
Should we kill two bottles then?
Why not?
I can't do the parlour tricks of saying, ah, yes, you know, that's a Latour 29, this is a Richebourg 34. I've tasted both of them, and I haven't got all that good a palate memory. But it's one of the great ones, I think I'd spot it. I managed to do it the other day about a wine that I'd never tasted in my life. I was rather proud of myself.
The big collection Arlott refers to was one of 4,000 bottles at his previous home in Hampshire. Now, with a somewhat smaller cellar in Alderney, it's down to a mere 1,000. A self-confessed magpie, he also has a magnificent collection of engraved glass.
It almost follows, you know, from being interested in wine, that you want to put it in good glasses. You get onto good glasses, and then you get on, or at least I did, too. Engraved glass, 19th century engraved glass, which in the days when I collected. It was pretty cheap. In fact, old George in Churchill's used to say, got some old rubbish for you over in the corner. I bought the old rubbish and still cherish it. It's very handsome. It's a wonderful medium, really, to work in, a glass engraver. I mean, a man like Lawrence Whistler, who stands alone. Well, he does stand alone, not so far alone as he used to do. But you've got there the combination of the great creative artist and the superb technician, which is very rare indeed.
The finest technician Arlott saw in his cricketing sphere was Sir Jack Hobbs.
Did you regard him as the greatest player that you've ever seen?
Yes, without a shadow of doubt. I mean, other people could do different things extremely well. But he was the one who I thought, and I'm not alone in this, this is not just a romantic concept. Other cricketers thought that he was the nearest thing to perfection that there had ever been.
You asked him to be godfather to Robert, your son.
Yes.
Which immediately he protested at, didn't he?
Yes, he said he wouldn't live long enough to steer him, and he said, I'll be his godfather, he said, if you get two more godfathers for when I'm gone. And came to that service the last time he ever left Hove. But he was that kind of kind man, you know, a kind man, a humble man, and a great man. No, I wasn't a good player, but I played an awful lot of cricket. I know what the problems are. And to be a commentator, you don't necessarily have to have been a top player. And some of the top players also were bad coaches. But I think you have to understand it and love it, want to talk about it. But you've got to understand the problems. If you can do that, if you know what the problems are, this enables you to understand the performer and to be sympathetic and to be talking about what he's feeling, which is the essential part about a commentary, I believe.
Vocabulary is important.
Oh, yes. Yes, everybody's got his different style. You see, I mean, mine, I suppose, is rather prolix, and I tend to talk in rolling periods. Everybody's got his own characteristic style. One thing is, it must be your characteristic style. You must talk naturally. I mean, I've heard commentators who I thought were terribly, terribly good and listen over the years and find that they've ceased to be themselves. They model themselves on somebody different. I never did, because I never heard anybody else.
Bit of the poet about you, though. Do you think that's coincidence?
Well, I used to write verse, and I did try in those days, of course, to pick the word that defined, as you must do, and try to pick the accurate word. Also the word that you feel. And you see, you just look at a cricket field and you see all this. And out of all that, you're picking little things. The big thing now, which is the event, when the bowler bowls, the batsman plays the stroke, the fieldsman does something. But apart from that, you're in a state of constant self-editing. You're picking things out of what you can see and mentioning them because they interest you, and you think somebody else may be interested. It's just what you notice, or perhaps don't notice anything at all, and you can be a very good commentator, of course, by coming up with the statistics and the hard facts and the records and so on. I don't do that because I can't remember them.
Throughout your life, though, John, you've always managed to put cricket in perspective.
Well, I don't think it's the only thing in the world. As C.L.R. James wrote in that very fine cricket book, Beyond a Boundary, what do they know of cricket who only cricket know? You must have something by which to measure it, some yardstick to measure its excitements, its dramas, its aesthetic quality. I think it's the best game in the world and the most complicated, but it is a game, you know, when I fear some people take it too seriously.
A comment that's reflected in his book collection. He does have a formidable array of cricketing reference books, yet they are but a fraction of a massive library littered with first editions and aquatints. They reflect the rounded man he's now become.
He worked a lot for me when I was a producer. He worked for me as a poetry reader. I was extremely fond of him. And I think of the poets of this century, he stands pretty well alone. Splendid man. Awful death wish on him.
You very nearly went into politics, didn't you? In fact, you did stand as a Liberal candidate twice.
I stood twice as a Liberal candidate. I trust a fairly loyal one, and it was a bad time then for the Liberals, and I like to think that perhaps when times were bad, I did help them along a little.
For a man who goes for the qualities in people, were you not disappointed at some of the qualities in politicians that you met?
Well, I've known one or two very, very nice ones. I mean, I worked a lot with Joe Grimmon, and I don't think you find a better man in any field of human activity in this country than Joe, or a much better brain. Absolutely splendid man. I find David Steele an extremely attractive personality, too. If there's one thing certain about the Liberals in Parliament in my lifetime, it is that they didn't go in there in the hope of feathering their nests.
But now there's a real chance that they might...
No, come. There's a chance with the SDP. Yes, there is. There is. I only hope that there's not going to be too much selfish and petty bickering by constituency parties about candidates. I hope it's going to be... This is the party's chance to be big and generous, and I hope it's not going to fail the opportunity.
Any regrets at all, John, that you didn't follow another path?
No, I think I've done as much with my life and my abilities as I was capable of doing. I don't think I could have done any better. I mean, the things I would have preferred to be. I would have loved to be a county cricketer, which, as Neville Rogers once said, indicated that I must be crazy. But, no, I couldn't have done better than I have. It's not great, it's not really important, but it was the best I could do.
Are the awards that you've won, particularly those in the last couple of years, are they important to you?
Yes, they are. I think they're the sort of thing that reinforces the confidence, or creates the confidence, that none of us really have. I never thought I was particularly good, and I've got a few little ornaments that say perhaps I was, and that's very warming, very rewarding, very comforting.
Is it important to you that people will remember you as a great commentator?
Oh, yes, that's very warming. I'm not sure that they will, but if they did, I think that was great. But I don't think there is any good commentary of mine recorded, as I wish there was.
Although his working life has run smoother than most, Arlott's private life has been shaken by two tragedies. One of his three sons was killed in a car accident when a teenager, and his second wife died of a sudden illness 5 years ago. His life now in Alderney is shared with his third wife, Pat.
My present wife has been terribly good for me since the two disasters, and I've been extremely lucky. My sons are all splendid.
Despite the tragedy, you seem very content, man.
I haven't got anything really to grumble about, but I think if you do get disasters that seem to you to be against the natural order of things... I mean, I was grieved when my mother and father died, but we know somewhere inside us that they'll probably go first. But when a younger wife and a son go, then this is terribly violent, and I think it leaves a mark on you all your life. It makes you a different kind of person. Perhaps not a worse person, indeed. It takes you out of the club of "it doesn't happen to me." You see, most of us, for most of our lives, belong to the club that says, "Ah, but it won't happen to me." But it does happen to some people, and if you're one of them, it changes your outlook.
Do you have any ambitions left now?
No. No, I don't have. Yes, I'd like to finish the book on the Beaujolais. That I really must do.
What about an autobiography?
always gives me a feeling of having one foot in the grave, the concept of joining an autobiography. If I was a footballer, I suppose I'd write it at 18, but... No, I'm not sure that I've finished. Maybe I have, but I'm not sure I have. And, I'd rather dislike the sort of egotism of an autobiography. I've striven for many years now never to use the first person singular in anything I write. Perhaps that's sort of inverted egotism. Perhaps it is. But I find the constant use of the first person irritating in any reading, and you'd be a bit pushed to write an autobiography without using the first person. I think it could be done, in fact, but it would be a bit of an affectation. Might do it if I become hard up enough.